Good afternoon. My name is Charlotte Wright, and I am one of the co-chairs of this school board forum. Tonight, I would like to welcome you and say that on November 8th, it's very important for us to get this right, just to choose the correct candidate for the school board. So please go out to grandmontcommunity.com and look at the questionnaires for each candidate. Thank you so much.
By the way, Charlotte's a real pleasure to work with because there are a lot of things she knows how to do that I don't, so I'll acknowledge that right up front. It's good to work as a team. Tonight, you know, I'm with her, by the way, but next to the presidential election, I think one of the most important things facing us as Detroiters is our own school board. As you know, for a generation, our students have operated under a system with the state takeover, and that the board here in Detroit has not had the power to run the organization, select a superintendent, and do the things that are needed. Our schools are probably the most important part of our kids' lives, and I think that this time we have an opportunity to elect a board that will select the next superintendent and drive forward the education programs here in Detroit. There's a lot of issues that are there. Life's not perfect, but the bottom line is this is a historic time for us, and I think we need to step up and try to do this. So as a result, I know that Charlotte and I started talking with Councilmember Tate and saying, look, we don't know all these folks. We need an opportunity to meet people, to get to know them, and to have a forum where each of us in Northwest Detroit can have that opportunity. So I think that one of the things I'd like to acknowledge right up front is without Councilmember Tate making the opportunity to videotape this provisions and put it up on Channel 22, as well as put it up on the website, many of our neighbors would not have the opportunity to hear who the candidates are, what they stand for, and what they offer in this very, very important election. I want to thank the candidates. Thank you, Councilmember Tate. I want to thank the candidates who took the time to fill out the surveys. I know 20 questions is, it's a game, I guess, that my kids used to play, but the reality is it's a very challenging thing. I know you've got a million things going on in your minds. So you've taken the time to fill out the surveys and participate in these events. So we appreciate your joining with us today and tonight. We had the first forum on Friday, October 7th. There was a very good turnout and participation, and those videos have already started running on Channel 22. So if you missed it, please take the time to take a look at it. We've included short bios in the material that you received tonight, as well as a sample ballot. We photocopied my absentee ballot, actually, and I guess when Kinko's did it, we cut off a couple names on the bottom. So don't use it as the absolute truth. Use your own ballot. But it gives you an idea of how complex the school board ballot is to take a look at that. So please use that to begin to identify the candidates that you would like to work with. Everyone's had an opportunity to pick up as you came in one of these 3x5 cards, the little index cards. We're using those to submit questions to the moderator. So if you have a question during the course of this event, please take a moment, fill it out, turn it in, and we'll try to get to as many of them as we can during the course of the evening. The moderators have got a series of questions already that they're going to be working with overall. So I want to just say a couple words about our moderators. Sarah Hewlett and Jerome Vaughn are both the public radio, Sarah with Michigan Public Radio and Jerome with WDET. I can't think of a more important tool for all of us to get information than public radio in Detroit. And as I said on Friday, I'm going to do a little plug. Even though the fundraisers are over, it's never too late to contribute to public radio, to keep them on the air doing the kinds of things that we need them to do. So thank you very much for joining us here. I'm going to introduce Councilman Tate to say a few words here at this point. And again, I want to thank him very much for his support in making this event possible. Thank you very much.
Good evening, everyone. So how many of you were at the forum last on the 7th? Okay, good number, folks. It was a great turnout. And what made it even better than that was the fact that we had quality candidates who were sitting on the stage and answering questions with real substance and not just the kind of stuff that we expect in this type of race. The truth of the matter is, it's been said, this is the first time that we're going to have a fully empowered school board in about 15 years. So we cannot take this for granted, ladies and gentlemen. The reason why we're here tonight in this particular location, in this space, on this day, is because we had, and I'll say this last week, we had two individuals, two residents of the city who said, you know what, this is important. We cannot allow this moment to pass us without doing everything we can to provide as much information as we have, as we can to the residents of this city. And I just want to, again, publicly thank Charlotte Wright, give a round of applause. And Phil Schlup. They're the ones that there was no organization behind them, just two residents who decided that this was important and they got involved. So thank both of you. The video, the last forum that took place on the 7th, if you have Comcast or AT&T, this is when you can watch it. If you have Comcast or AT&T, Comcast is channel 10 or 22, AT&T UVerse is channel 99. The times that they'll be played on Thursday and Friday, that's tomorrow and Friday, 11 a.m., 4 p.m., and 8 p.m. It's also being shown tonight as well, but you know, you're here. So again, just want to say thank you to you guys for putting this together, and to the candidates, congratulations. This is a long race, I knew it was, but we're almost there. Thank you for your willingness to get involved and be a part of this process. God bless you all.
Thank you, Councilmember. In addition to Councilmember Tate helping to distribute the information on this, our State Representative Sherry Gay Denogo has been very helpful in broadcasting this. I don't think she's here yet. And also, she donated the refreshments, so I think we doubly thank her, okay? I also want to thank the church here tonight with Bushnell working with us to make this a possibility. And State Senator David Kinesick and Wayne County Commissioner Alicia Bell have also been very helpful in terms of trying to broadcast and distribute the information relative to this activity. So we thank you for being here. I know there's someone here from the League of Women Voters tonight, and to be honest, we stole a lot of your format because we wanted the opportunity for people to hear these candidates. So thank you very much for what you've done all these years, and you can pick up their literature in the back. Without further ado, I'd like to turn it over to the moderators and let them start with the questions. So thank you very much for being here. We appreciate it.
First of all, thank you all for coming this evening. Just a reminder, you have 2 minutes, and we have a very stringent timekeeper right there with signs, so please keep that in mind as you answer your questions. This first question goes to Tawana Simpson. You say in your response to one of the questions, you want the best educational institution that exists. This means the board must expect all staff and students to excel. How will the district look when all staff and students excel? What form will that excellence take?
I really didn't hear you. Can you speak into the mic? Because it's very hard to hear up here.
Yep, I'll be a little louder.
Thank you.
You say you want the best educational and best educational institution that exists. That means the board must expect all staff and students to excel. Mm-hmm. How will the district look when all staff and students excel? What form will that excellence take?
Oh, well, what we will have at that time is a district that's educating students, and a district who will have their community involved. Parents would be involved, and that we would see our children excelling. I mean, that's the ultimate goal. We want to see a district that will and is capable of educating all the students that come through their doors.
Next question. Hello, there we go. Sorry, it's hard for us to see some of you on the left side of the stage, so I apologize for that. This question is for Angelique Peterson-Mayberry. Hi. In your written materials, you say the district needs to adjust spending to focus on instruction, and you also cite the need to eliminate waste. Where do you think there is waste currently in the district?
I'm sorry, like Tawana, it's very hard to hear up here. I didn't even hear you. It sounds very muffled. It okay. sounds very muffled for some reason. I can't really hear you.
Okay, I'll do my best. I'll speak up a little bit. In your written materials, you say that the district needs to adjust spending to focus on instruction. And you also cite the need to eliminate waste. Where do you think there is currently waste in the district?
So when you look at the budget, what I would like to see is that majority of the budget go toward academic instruction and to our educators. But I understand that there also needs to be an opportunity where we have vendors, where we pay for safety. And so there are some wraparound services that I would like to see paid for as well. So when I say waste, anything that does not directly affect the academic excellence of our children may be wasteful, depending on how much is being spent and allocated for that particular venture.
Have you identified any particular spots that you think are wasteful?
So without seeing a budget, that's very difficult to answer. I would need to see it to see what would be considered wasteful, because I think, I mean, just like a budget in your house, there are some things that you can cut back on. For instance, you can cook instead of going out to eat every day. So I would need to see what the budget says so that I will know what would be deemed. Were we, you know, if you categorize it as wasteful is one thing, or to say that it just doesn't have a direct impact on educating and excelling our children.
Thank you.
This is for the Reverend Dr. Keith Whitney. In your survey, you say education has to be a priority if the city is to have a sustained comeback. Why do you think that's the case?
I believe that an educated population matters. Though we are building downtown and in Corktown and other places, it is going to be tremendously important for us to have an educated populace. The reports go out that they can't find enough folks to work in the projects here in the city of Detroit. Well, that's really a part of our responsibility. The other part of it is having qualified people to, again, be in government and other places. And we as a city have to have an academic institution that prepares our young folks, not just for college, and though that's an important idea, but also to be able to function within the community. I think for me, it's important that we have a thinking population. Unfortunately, we can test our children to death, and they're good at taking tests. But the challenge that we're going to have is having people to do critical thinking, to be able to do more than just pass a test, but also to function within our society. So I think that's why it's so important.
Thank you.
This question is for Philip Caldwell. Mr. Caldwell, in your survey, you say that the new district is projected to have an operating deficit of $100 million a year.
That is what I said, yes.
Yeah, if you could just talk a little bit about where that figure comes from, and why don't you take that first?
So that information came from the district's transition report that was provided to every candidate who was running for office, who attended two board briefing sessions provided by Judge Rhodes. So although the budget presented this year and for the next 2 years represents a conservative estimate on student enrollment and per pupil allocation, the revenue optimization team, which had the current CFO sit on that committee, estimates that the special education provisions has a potential shortfall. There's also an annual facilities cost that has a shortfall. And so that number actually comes from page 70 plus once you get into the okay. litany of that report.
Okay, so second part of that question, just about every candidate who submitted a questionnaire talks about the importance of paying teachers more and smaller class sizes and bringing back art and music. How do you reconcile those competing ideas?
So I'm not prepared to reconcile the ideas. I think that they're valid. I think that all of us who are running are not permitted to approve or pass any initiative or budget without a majority. And so I would say first, whomever's elected, we'd have to work together to figure out what the vision and the priorities represent. And then structurally, we'll have to look at what budget resources we have at the district's discretion. And by resources, I do mean both financial, human, and material. So that involves the community, businesses, the mayor's office, so forth and so on.
Thank you.
This question is for Misha Stallworth. In your survey, you say it's important to identify creative methods to generate revenue, including but not limited to establishing philanthropic and corporate partnerships. What are some other ways you think the district can generate revenue?
So, I mean, on the ballot right now, there's the millage for Wayne County Educational Enhancement. And so that in and of itself is another way to generate revenue for the district. When I look at the budget and I think about the deficits that Mr. Caldwell just pointed out, part of it is that if you're already operating with that deficit, it's not so much about creating revenue or generating revenue as it is identifying ways to free up what it already exists. It's about moving things and making sure that things are properly allocated. So that's really what I was speaking to, is the allocations, making sure that they're appropriate, and then identifying partnerships that can bring in other types of resources. So those resources could be school supplies, those resources could be after school programming, but there is a litany of resources that can come in from other sources.
Just a quick follow-up, is there any organization or organizations in particular that you have in mind?
Well, we know already that UAW Ford has a huge partnership with DPS and does a lot of expansion within our school, so I would look to strengthen that. I also would be looking at foundations and also at our municipality, at our city, for expanding things like student council. But I think first we have to make sure that everything is fiscally sound so that foundations and philanthropies feel comfortable in making that investment.
Thank you.
This question is for John Telford. In your questionnaire, you talk about the fact that the district needs an attendance and disciplinary policy with teeth. Can you elaborate on that?
And thank you for bringing that question up. We currently do not have a viable disciplinary policy, and we certainly don't have a viable attendance policy, because as I walk the streets of Detroit, I see kids who are supposed to be in school and aren't. It was unfortunate that they cut back the attendance department practically to the bare bones. I would see the necessity for perhaps reallocating that money and restoring that program and that process, perhaps at the expense of some other areas that could rather be cut, because the teachers can't teach an empty seat, and this unfortunately is what is happening in many of our schools right now. We have a monumental truancy rate in the Detroit Public Schools that needs to be rectified.
Thank you.
This is for Angelique Peterson Mayberry. In your questionnaire, you say the funds that are available must be used to focus on achievement with proven methods that promote excellence. How would you define excellence in DPS-CD?
How would I define what?
Excellence.
Oh, excellence. So I think excellence is making sure that our children are prepared. What we don't see is that there are a lot of programs that have been cut that prepares them for life. Not necessarily if they're going to college, but just life. You know, when I was in middle school, I had home ec, I had cooking, I had sewing. And so a well-rounded person, there's excellence involved and embedded in a well-rounded person. It's not all academics when you're talking about educating the total student, because there's more to it than academics, just like there's more to excellence than testing.
Thank you.
You guys are taking way less than the 2 minutes. We'll get through this quickly. This question is for Penny Baylor. In your written materials, you talk about your excellent track record of financial success in managing large budgets. But the circumstances under which you left the Girl Scouts included an audit that uncovered a large deficit and allegations of mismanagement. Can you explain that situation to the audience and talk about what you learned from it?
Yes, I learned a great deal from it. That's a great question. I had been there 15 years at that point, and 16, and for the first 15 and a half, I had an outstanding, fabulous chief financial officer. Laverne Sims, I'll share her name, she's outstanding. And when you have great staff, you bond together and you work together beautifully. We had a great finance committee, and things went very, very well. We had 13 years in a row of balanced budgets. That year, she, which was totally deserved, she had been in Leadership Detroit. I had wanted her to get networking opportunities. And she was offered a corporate job with a corporate company as a vice president. So after 15 and a half years, she had planned to stay five, she took this great job. At that time, which was about 1999, there was a real shortage of CPAs and CFOs who wanted to work in Detroit. My finance committee, I asked several of the top financial officers, could they help me recruit a replacement for Laverne? Even they were not able to. They said, we're looking for somebody for our company as well. It's very, very hard. The city was not doing well, and a lot of people just didn't want to work in the city. So I finally did hire a young person who had been her deputy. He was wonderful, but he was young, and he was much less experienced. And when the financials were presented before the audit, there was an error. He had failed to count a month of accumulated expenses that was going over into the next fiscal year. So it was an error, and we felt terrible about it, but it was quickly rectified in the next fiscal year. But I did learn a lot from that, and one of the things was you can't do it all alone. Sometimes you try to take on so much, and I should have gotten a search firm or something to get a really higher qualified CFO to come in and replace Laverne. It would have cost some money, but it probably would have paid off. He was in a little bit over his head. He was a wonderful person. I still adore him, but there was a big mistake made.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
This is for Carol Pratt Farver. In your written remarks, you say DPSCD is at a crossroads and that it needs a diverse and strong board that will advance the work of the transition team while blocking the negative actions of state government. What does that look like?
What does it look like in respect to what?
How will you have a diverse and strong board that will block the negative actions of state government?
Well, the diverse team would be the individuals selected for the board. That was what my statement was in reference to. What I would like to see is a diverse team who would be able to address all issues. I think the team needs to be diverse enough where their different expertise and that they can bring their talents as a team and work on two things, which is bringing the system, the school system back to what it needs to be, bringing it to excellence, as well as working to free it up from being so related or so attached to the state. Because we have to do that in order for us to go forward. Right now, having the state watching over us is almost like it's a big problem. And it creates a negative image, it creates a lot of tension, and it's a situation that should not exist.
All right, thank you.
This next question is for Reverend David Murray. In your questionnaire, you say that a quality education would mean 80% of students would be employed or enrolled in post-secondary education. Right now, the district, to my knowledge, correct me if I'm wrong, doesn't track students once they leave the district. Is that something you would want to see happen, and how do you make that a priority given the district's financial challenges and other needs?
Well, I believe that our district need to reprioritize its financial needs and put students first instead of making friends at the top, and that's what seems to be happening. And therefore, the resources are not going to empower our children. We want to, I would like to see money put forth to track the students, and number one, to put plans, something in place to help guide the children toward a future when they graduate, and to track them and follow them and continue to counsel them when they finish high school, at least a year, so that they will have some kind of a plan to move forward. And I believe this can happen if we allocate our funds properly, and if we do that, we can make it. Then do it, so never worry, vote for Murray.
Thank you.
This question is for Ms. Simpson. In answer to the question of what quality education for the 21st century looks like, you said, quote, "It looks like the best that other school districts are now providing for their students." More specifically, what are some of those bests that are offered elsewhere?
Well, in my research, I found that a lot of other school districts teach the students learning styles. So you have different type of learning styles. You have those students who learn well from listening. You have those students learn who are kinesthetic, which I am, who learn through project work and things like that. So I think if we tailor curriculum not only to different subject matters, also to how students learn, and looping. I think looping is something that is needed, and it would be a great way for students who need to catch up or need some remedial help to do. And what looping is when one teacher keeps a set of students for maybe 1 or 2 years. In my research, I've even found they stay 3 years. But then that gives the teacher, the parent, and the student plenty of enough time to get to know each other, how each other works well with each other, and what each student needs to succeed.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Just a note, we got kind of mixed up, and so a couple of you had two questions, but we'll try to work it out in the end. This question is for Elena Arata. You've been unapologetic about your, what some might call, antagonistic role when it comes to dealing with the emergency managers and Judge Rhodes. What kind of success do you think that strategy has had? Can you hear me?
Mm-hmm. Okay. I believe that it has stopped the EAA from expanding. Myself and collectively our board has stopped the expansion of the EAA. We have, through our own efforts, had volunteer accountants who told us not to sign financial statements from the emergency manager when there were blank columns that didn't have anything at the bottom. They wanted us to sign as elected board members. We have we did protest settlements to predators and hope that the exposure of the danger that our children have been in has been in some way minimized for the next people coming in. We have we appear to be very negative because there have been terrible transgressions against our schools and our district. Taking 15 schools that we pay for until 2039 and putting children in there to fail and paying someone $500,000 and going forward the same without any remediation to those students, but paying 24/7 security for all the people who are doing this to us because they do need to be protected from us. Those are the kinds of things that may sound negative, and I will definitely own up to being very negative on the attacks on our children and on our schools. We have questioned buildings being leased while we have open buildings gaping. We have 77 buildings that Mayor Duggan took from the school board last year without paying a penny because they said that we owed water runoff money for them. They are buildings that have new upgrades on them. All of these are beautiful buildings, but you know what? They're going to be waiting for charters to come in. So when they say that they're going to close another 20 or 30 schools coming in, those are going to be given to cronies for charters. So if I sound negative, it's actually truth.
This question is for Deborah Hunter Harville. Several candidates, including yourself, have mentioned the desire to partner with philanthropic groups. This is a two-part question. First of all, how do you make long-term funding plans with money that may not be long-term? And second, how do you make sure those groups are executing the district's agenda and not their own?
So good evening to everyone. It's good to see so many present, okay? And let me go back to what I think I heard. It is blurred, but I'll do my best. In terms of long-term funding, are you asking me how do you get philanthropic groups to come forth and say, yes, I'll pledge to be a long-term funder?
Exactly. How do you make long-term funding plans with money from philanthropic groups that may not be long-term?
Okay. The way I would do that is based on some experiences I've had in the past. Once you go and meet with funders, or you have perhaps a team of folk to go and meet with funders, you talk about what it is that you need to have funded and what the research would say would be a nice amount of years in order to see some proactive change, okay? Once you talk about that, you ask the funders, would they be willing to come on for 6 years and sign a pledge or some kind of memorandum of understanding? And if they would be willing to do that, then you would also give them the specificity that would make that work. And so when you talk about how you execute that, I would execute that with perhaps an advisory council or a cadre of persons such as building principals. They could always let us know what they need. I would also execute that by, of course, having teachers. I would also include parapros, maybe a custodian, all the folk and the secretary, the folk that make it work along with a parent. And you talk about consistently what you need and you monitor it and make sure that it's happening, that you're getting that, you X that off the list, and then you go to the next group. And I think that those teams of folk could probably meet quarterly, but because we need so much, my time is up, I'll try to attach it on the other end of the next question.
Okay, thank you.
My pleasure.
Mr. Caldwell, I've got you next. Why don't you tackle the second part of that question, which is when you're, because you also talked about partnering with philanthropic groups. How do you make sure that those groups are executing the district's agenda and not their own?
So it's going to sound a little redundant. So not me, but a like-minded body of six other people, or at least the majority of those individuals, would have to agree to what is our vision. So my vision for our district are that we, for the 45,000 something odd kids that we're teaching, every single kid, not one less kid, every single kid is a productive citizen when they finish with us. So I would hope that like-minded individuals like myself would say to any philanthropic organization, that is our goalpost. Can you help us to get there? And from that place, we work to ensure that they're at the table at all times and work collaboratively with them. But I'm not here to say who, how, or what, because again, boards don't act based on what Philip Caldwell II says. It acts based on what the majority says is the vision and the goal set forth.
Thank you.
Dr. Whitney, you say there is a direct correlation between poverty, a lack of parental involvement, student retention, and discipline. How would you make an impact on those key issues as a board member?
I believe that as a board member, I try to get my other board members to look at the reality that parental involvement is tremendously important with our students. Poverty is going to be here. Because we are poor does not mean we have to stay where we are. I believe that it is the role of the education system to show a better way, if you will. I believe if we're working with parents, getting them involved with their students, getting them involved, and in some cases we may have to help parents learn how to read, learn how to write. So getting with our parents, as well as the students, we want to work with them so that they can see life beyond their block, life beyond their buddies, and even life beyond Detroit. And that means that as an educational institution, we have to expose our young folks to the very best in the world.
Thank you.
This next question is for John Telford. How, and this is an audience question, how will you start holding principals accountable for improving the high school graduation rate?
Yeah, that's an excellent question, because the high school graduation rate in DPS at this point is far lower than stated. It's 21%, and most of those graduates are girls. So you can imagine the social dynamite that's being perpetrated among young men, you know, who will be coming out of our schools in one way or another. How do you get the graduation rate up? Well, number one, let's teach the kids to read. You know, we've got secondary school students in the middle schools and the high schools who are reading below the fourth grade level, and well below the fourth grade level. There are some statisticians that have been working with our, you know, with our rightful democratically elected board that's been sitting for the past several years, and valiantly serving their time in serving the students. And these statisticians, James Hare and Quick to Learn, Tom Pedroni from Wayne State University, they have given us some appalling statistics. And those statistics have been revealed, not all of them. Some of them are new, and I have some in my own chart. Matter of fact, you know, I wrote a poem about it. My poem is, I have a vision in my heart and in my spirit and my soul that Motown's children in my chart will never have to pay the toll of poverty and ravaged mind, or end up dead or on the dole, but will in education find their life-affirming future goal. These statistics, and I have them, if anyone wants to email me, Dr. John Telford, edd@aol.com. Okay, I lost my 2 minutes, but I'll be talking about this more in future answers. Thank you.
Ms. Stallworth, in your response to a question, you talk about the importance of school culture. What can board members do to impact school culture?
So I think that board members, as advocates for student well-being, can provide research to administrators, to school leadership. I think that they can facilitate processes by which principals are working with teachers and with other school staff to determine what the school culture will be. Oftentimes, when we talk about school culture and we think about school culture, we're thinking about disciplinary actions. We're thinking about the rules that students have to follow. We're thinking about school uniforms and all of the things that kind of put our students in boxes, quite frankly. But when I think about school culture, I think about what are the things that make a school, make a student feel ownership over their building, that make them feel connected to the people within it and connected to their other students, and also connected to the community surrounding the school. So I think that as a board, it's important to provide that support, provide that research, provide that guidance in figuring out what that school culture should be, and then providing support as they try to implement it to the superintendent who's doing the real oversight and implementation of policies and procedures.
Thank you.
This next question is for Reverend Murray. Name one creative method to engage parents for better participation to strengthen schools.
I would like the parents to understand that if your children are going to have a future at all, the parents must be involved in every aspect of the children's learning. Our parents must understand we still live in a racist society, a society where the people in the power structure do not want your child to succeed. It's a dog-eat-dog world. In order for your child to succeed, we as parents must give them the tools they need to succeed. We must teach them the facts of life. We must be the one to be the teachers, the preachers, those who guide the children, and not sit back and depend on no one else, not even the teachers. We should join forces with the teachers to teach. We should be partners with the teachers, but we should not sit back and let nobody guide our children to the future, and we put our hands behind our backs and just let somebody else do it. We should work together in every aspect of our children's learning and empower our children. That's what I do for mine. That's why I say never worry, vote for Murray.
This next question is for Rita Carpenter. You say in your questionnaire, parent workshops in services must be held regularly. Parents should be rewarded for their participation, volunteering within the school and outside the school building. How do you reward or entice parents to do that?
Good evening, families. I want to first thank you for the opportunity to be here. And we reward parents through incentives that their children can receive, okay, to encourage them to continue to support their children. Workshops, because I advocate what I said in my answers, because those are the things that I did. I've been teaching for 40 years now, and those are the things that I did. At my schools, we had parent workshops, and the reward was that rewards for themselves was the fact that they were able to come out to a workshop, they're able to learn parenting skills, they're able to learn money management skills, health and nutrition skills, how to parent their children. They were able to learn college and career planning, because that's how my workshops were structured, so that parents would be able to help their children. You know, we're in this together, the seven of us that are elected. We have to work cohesively to empower the parents through helping them. If you didn't know the statistics, which is appalling, about third graders in our state, I read the article, maybe you did too. Only 50% of third graders in our state can read, okay? And now that translates into many of their parents can't read. So we must empower the parents with all the tools they need. The board is a trustee for the community, for the parents and the children. And if we put our collaborative efforts together, I've already got the plans worked out. I've already met with the superintendent about the plans to improve literacy, which is gonna be improved through the plan that I discussed with Ms. Merriweather. And so I already got the plan set up. We're gonna have corporate America adopt schools. And I already got the list of the corporate American sponsors already set to adopt the school. So I've been working and thinking and planning. And thank you, families. And my name is Rita McFadden Carpenter. Put a teacher on the board. And thank you.
Thank you.
This question's for Penny Baylor. In talking about the need for career and vocational training, you mentioned in your questionnaire wanting to replicate the strategies used in the Diplomas Now schools. Can you talk a little bit more about what that is all about?
Ooh, I would love to. Diplomas Now is a national coalition of three national nonprofits: City Year, which I led for 14 years and which Misha served in Chicago, City Year, Communities in Schools, and Johns Hopkins University. And Johns Hopkins University did the seminal research nationwide on the early warning indicators of dropping out. And the four early warning indicators are attendance, behavior, coursework in math and English. And if a child in the 10th grade is failing in any one of those areas, if you're not coming to school, you can't learn. If you're not behaving well, you probably get kicked out of school. If you're flunking math or if you're flunking English in the 10th grade, only 20% of those children will graduate, because they have to go on and pass 11th grade math and English, and then 12th grade math and English. So the design of diplomas now is to have a team of core members in the school, a communities in school social worker, certified social worker in the school, to focus on those four areas: attendance, behavior, math and English, and track with data and move the kids along until they're at grade level, and then keep them there. It's working all over the country in 12 cities, and we're very proud to have it in Detroit as well.
This question is for Ms. Farver. With regard to hiring and procurement, you say you want to see processes put in place that include identifying relationships with DPS staff and involving multi-level approvals. Could you talk a little bit more about what you'd like to see on that front?
What I would like to see is a process that has multi-levels of approval based on monetary values. That's one. I would also like to see where any individuals who are dealing with resources or finances have to go through an annual process to recertify or reaffirm or recommit to being a responsible person for the services that they are procuring. I would also like to see a formalized process of paperwork, a trail from procurement to delivery, as far as delivery of the product as well as delivery of the finances. Every step needs to be accounted for, and that is the system that I would like to see. As far as where it is, who signed for it, the value, the money spent, all of that needs to be tracked. It needs to be trackable and as part of the procurement process. So that was one part, and the other part, as I said before, is making sure that people sign an annual statement that says they do not have relationships with any of these vendors. They do not have relationships with anyone for which they are doing business on behalf of DPS. Those are the processes and procedures, and I'm sure I'm missing a few others, that I would like to see in place. I would also like to see that information in electronic format so that you can do any kind of pull of a report at any particular time and validate it on the spot.
Thank you.
This next question is for Elena Arata. It's from the audience. Please share your feelings about the job that our current interim superintendent, Alicia Merriweather, is doing.
Well, I actually, in fairness to her, she has very little authority. And in other districts that are not under emergency managers, and just to put that in a shorthand, white districts, the elected boards choose their superintendent. And Ms. Merriweather was selected by the emergency manager. And there is no stability in those positions. She has nothing to say about the amount of money that's going to be spent. That's up to the Financial Review Commission. She has nothing to say about the teacher's salaries. We have hundreds of positions open for teachers that cannot be filled. She can do nothing about that. She can do nothing about 45 students contractually in a classroom and bonuses for teachers who have more than that. She can do nothing about the continuous parade of contractors that are able to influence the curriculum. So in fairness to Ms. Merriweather, she doesn't have any authority, and I also would like to amend a statement that was made by the facilitator when we first came in. The new board is nothing near fully empowered. If you don't have the authority to spend money or vet contracts or hire a superintendent, open and close buildings, you have no authority. So the newly elected board must know that it is completely untrue that any board is going to have full control until we have the same things as the white districts have, and that would be the right to govern, the same as the white districts, and to an audit.
Thanks.
Right. If we could hold the applause until the end, just so we're not wasting time. Ms. Carpenter, in your questionnaire, you place a lot of emphasis on phonics. I know you're a teacher. Why do you have that emphasis on phonics? You mentioned it several times in your questionnaire.
Yes, I sure did. Actually, from my own personal experience, I'm the mother of two children, and when I realized that neither one of my children could read, I went to a phonics specialist who was educated in another state. The requirements for teachers in the state that she was educated in is different from our state. You know, in our state, a teacher is only required to take one phonics class. Now, do the math. If you think a person can be proficient teaching, learning, taking one class, I'm going to assure you they cannot. So that the teachers, as the teacher told me, Ms. Carpenter, your children have never been taught how to read. The teachers they had don't know how to teach reading. They've never been required to take enough phonics classes to be proficient. So that's number one. That's the key. The key to much of this is the children have to learn how to read. And that's why I mentioned in my recent answer, we have a plan to make that happen. We're going to make sure the teachers preschool through grade 8 are in service and taught phonics so that if a child comes from another district, fell through the cracks, they in the eighth grade, they'll have an eighth grade teacher who can teach them the phonics. That's how you learn how to read. That's how I learned how to read. But when my children came through, they're 10 years apart. Neither one of my children were taught how to read. The teacher's only required to take one class. They don't know how to teach reading, and they still don't. Teachers do not know how to teach reading. So it's critical. That's step one. We got to get the children reading, and that's tied into phonics. Okay, they had a whole language program, which didn't work. So the only program I know for sure worked, it worked for my children. My daughter's a college graduate. My son would have been a college graduate had something horrific not happened to him in Detroit. But my son was a senior in college. Okay, my son tested when he went to start the ninth grade. His reading level was tested as a first-year college student because my children were taught how to read by a phonics teacher who was proficient in phonics. It's critical that children learn phonics.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Ms. Hunter Harville, in talking about your experience as a principal, you mentioned the need to use data. From what you know about what the district is doing right now, how is data being used well, and how is it either not being used or not being used well?
From what I know about the district, just speaking with various principals, they're instructional leaders, and you look at the data where perhaps kids didn't score high, and then you focus your lesson plans and your teaching instruction to help kids have critical thinking skills in order to do better maybe the next time around that they take the test. I believe they take about 4 tests per school year. It could be more, it could be less, so I don't really want to say. I haven't been inside of a school for the last couple of months since I've been running for office, because I don't want to, you know, walk in like I'm already in office. I do volunteer at other schools and help read, but that's how I use the data. Let me look at how many more seconds I have. Did I say enough about the data?
You're talking about how it should be used. Is that how you see
that's
it being used?
That's how teachers perhaps that are now principals and assistant principals that worked with me, I know that's how they use the data, because that's how we mentored. That's how we had our staff meetings. That's how we were able to get our test scores up, by letting kids know that they need to have some critical thinking skills so that they can move forward in learning. So yeah, I would say that's the best way to do it. I'd have to talk with the interim superintendent to see where she is with that now.
Thank you.
So we have a few questions here for all of you, just as we're just about the halfway point here. And so this is just a question for a show of hands, so just raise your hands. How many of you have studied PA 192? How many of you have lived in Detroit for 10 years or more? How many of you have a background in education? How many of you have read Judge Rhodes' 180-day plan?
Can you hear me? How many of you have met with Judge Rhodes and or Alicia Merriweather? How many of you have school-aged kids or grandkids? And of those of you who just raised your hand, how many of you send your kids to a DPS school or grandkids? Okay. How many of you have been in a school library in the past year?
You mean the guts of a school
that,
library?
That counts too,
right.
Yeah.
Okay. Right.
Mm-hmm. And how many of you volunteer at a neighborhood school? Thanks.
Okay. This question is for Dr. Whitney. You're running on a platform stressing transparency in regards to past missteps affecting public education in Detroit. How will you ensure transparency?
Again, I cannot do it alone. It has to be the board. I believe that open meetings are tremendously important. I believe that public knowledge of the budget is important. And I also believe that what happens in the school system is important. I do recognize that, again, I cannot do it by myself, but I believe that the board we'll take a look at the idea that we have to be, because we are public servants, that we are responsible to the public and we have to act like it.
Just to follow up, what are some ideas that you would convince the board about, that what sort of efforts might you lead as far as transparency?
Well, I believe that it's important, again, open meetings, that as a board and as public servants, the meetings that we have are open to the public. I believe that also that the budget and its processes would be open to the public as well. I think the other part of it is telling our own story as a public school system, because I think that unfortunately for us, we have not told who we are. We've let other people tell our story, and I believe that once we, as a board, if you will, can do that, then maybe we can infect the rest of our city to know about the good things of DPS. Thank you.
This question is for Philip Caldwell. What plans do you have to bring our educational system out of the 36th place in the world?
So first and foremost, I would welcome an opportunity to work with six other people on November 9th, because even though we don't take office until January 1st, the work is going to start the very next day. Pragmatically, I would agree with Ms. Baylor's point earlier, but I would take it a step further and say it's not, diplomas now is a brand, but the philosophy behind Johns Hopkins says that we have to start at the middle. So we lose kids at third grade, and so we really have to do academic behavior and discipline monitoring much, much earlier on so that they don't fall through the cracks when they get to eighth grade and then high school and beyond. And so pragmatically, I would advocate and ask the board to really investigate policies that we can put in place to ensure that early on that we can have a early warning system at the third grade, fourth, fifth, and so on level.
Ms. Simpson, many of you on this panel advocate for additional state funding. Barring that, how will you make sure the budget is balanced and schools are getting what they need to achieve the district's goals?
Well, first, we will have to definitely spend more time in Lansing because our budget is allocated through the legislature. So therefore, we will have to make sure that our legislators, our state reps, our state senators know what it is that we want. We're gonna have to make sure that we understand every student's Succeeds Act. We're going to have to understand how Common Core plays a role in these things, and we're just going to have to keep ourselves educated so that we can work well with the legislators and make sure that the right amount of money is appropriated. As a school board member, we basically work with what's allocated to us. And of course, we can go out and we can look for, you know, help from nonprofits and things like that, but I'm a firm believer that we can do it within our district. I think that we can take a lot of the things that we want nonprofits to do and other entities to do, and make sure that we train our parents and community to do it for our school district. I know, sitting on the board, that in the last 5 years, for the first 2 or 3 years, every single board meeting, we had someone coming in wanting to give our district something free that each one of the emergency managers that we had at that time turned down. So basically, all we really have to do is sit in place, make sure we vet those who come to us, make sure that we keep ourselves educated, make sure that we spend as much time in our community as we will have to in Lansing, and I do think that we can work this out. Thank you.
This question is for John Telford. In your questionnaire, you mentioned a program that I think you probably say Quick to Learn.
Yes.
A couple of times, and also its $500,000 price tag. Can you talk more about what it is and why you're so adamant about implementing it?
Well, I'm adamant about implementing a program like that. Quick to Learn certainly would be one bidder. Because what none of us have really addressed, and what certainly the interim superintendent and emergency manager aren't addressing, and past ones have not addressed, other than me, when I was the board's appointed pro bono superintendent, we need to focus on the priority schools. We have 40 of 67 of our elementary schools in the city that are priority schools. Now, Quick to Learn has a resource proven process to bring those priority schools up to reading level within 1 year and bring them actually beyond reading level. I'm talking about the kids in the first and second grade, but they can do it, you know, K-12. And the price tag for that or for any similar program would be about $500,000. But the difference between Quick to Learn and also some like organizations in the state of Utah that have been pioneering this is that they will only collect their $500,000 if they perform what they promise they will perform. In other words, it's a pay for performance. That's revolutionary. And when we talk about balancing budgets and saving money, I would certainly say that I would want to put out a request for folks to bid on a contract like this. They have offered their services to past administrations. And why they didn't take it, you know, is a total mystery to me. But if I do get elected to this board, I will try to do what I was trying to do when I was the rightful board's pro bono superintendent, get a program like that implemented.
This question is for Ms. Peterson Mayberry. You call for the district to, as you say, properly market what it does well so that parents have the information on what opportunities are available for their students. What exactly would that look like?
So I think that the district does a very good job of telling everybody what's wrong. And so if you're a parent on the fence about sending your child to the district, it's very difficult because there are great things happening in the district, and we know my kids have been in it since Bates Academy, where they went. And now I have one at Cass and one at CMA, a senior and a freshman. I'm a product of Detroit Public Schools, Martin Luther King High School. And I think that what people need to understand is the good things that are happening need to be marketed. It's no way that you will continue to send your child to a district when all you hear was wrong. They watch television, they see people fighting over them, they go to meetings, they hear people fighting, and at the end of the day, they do not feel that they're valued. They have never once been asked what they want. And I've sat with young people and I've heard that. So a good marketing strategy to me would be to market what's going on very well in the district. There's Montessori schools that are coming. People are paying for Montessori schools. DPS has Montessori schools now. They've sent teachers to get trained to teach that. There are things that we have an aerospace program. I was at Davis Aerospace and sat in a simulator. High school students know how to fly planes.
Are you kidding me? For free in public education. So we've got to stop talking so much about what's wrong if we're trying to get the increase in the enrollment.
This question is for Reverend Murray. When you were serving on the board, Reverend Murray, what would you say was your greatest accomplishment as a board member?
Creating the Yellow Jacket Brigade that created more community involvement with the school district, helping establish the Public Schools Police Department, and establishing the African Center Education Program. And those things, I believe, help increase student learning, reduce the behavioral problems within the school, including the violence and drugs. And I would like to see that continued. And I'd like to continue to see parents involved in the process. And in order to do that, I'd like to see the community work together and demand that the state government, including Governor Snyder, take their hands off of Detroit Public Schools and let our children learn and let our teachers teach. So therefore, never worry, vote for Murray.
This question is for Ms. Stallworth. What can you do specifically to make DPSED a tri-county competitor for students?
So I think a lot of what I can do has to do with working with my fellow board members and developing policies and procedures that hold the schools to a high standard, but also provide resources and support for them to meet those standards. For me, as a person who went to the University of Chicago, which is, you know, one of the best schools in the nation, I have a very comprehensive way of looking at education and looking at what competition really means. I think that it has a lot to do with students being able to think critically, being able to solve big problems, and not necessarily just answer a math problem. I think it also has to do with students being empowered to create programs and know how to monitor and implement them within their own communities. And I think those are the things that, when you look at the Tri-County area and you look at the things that are celebrated in other communities, they're things that are happening here already and not being marketed, but there are also things that there are opportunities to bring into seed. And so those are the things that I'd be looking for, not the expertise of other board members, because I don't know everything. I know a lot, I do, but I don't know everything. So I'd be looking for the expertise and the background of my fellow board members and the resources and partnerships and connections that they bring. And then I would also be looking at that comprehensive approach to education.
Thank you.
This is for Ms. Baylor. It's an audience question. Student athletes are currently forced to practice and compete on subpar fields and in subpar facilities, which are below MHSAA minimal standards. This has caused many parents to move their student athletes to other districts. How will you address this serious issue?
Well, I'll give you an example. I'm very privileged to chair the board at Detroit Collegiate Prep at Northwestern. And recently, the UAW, Jimmy Settles, who's an alumni of Northwestern High School, contributed over $1 million in facilities improvements and had hundreds of volunteers from the UAW come and institute them. You should see their facilities. They are spectacularly gorgeous. Two swimming pools completely renovated and in top condition. A weight room, the basketball court, everything there for the students. That's one example. When I was on the school board, when Deborah McGriff was superintendent, there had been three drownings in three different pools in DPS. I happened to have been a water safety instructor for a long time, and it just broke my heart. And in all three times, the lifeguard was really liable, wearing all their clothes and their shoes, not paying attention, reading, talking to people, and there'd be 40 kids in the water, and one would slip under and drown. So what we did, it took me 2.5 years. We got every pool with underwater lights. The pools were often painted a dark color, which is not smart. and we painted the pools a light color, underwater lights, and trained, had specific training for the water safety instructors. So I think you have to use partnerships, but you also have to use common sense. That was disgraceful. And I sat on the steps with the parents of one of those children, and it really broke my heart. So it's a lot of things, but I think there's a lot of people out there that really love Detroit, that want to come back and help Detroit. They were alumni of DPS, and we need to call upon them to step up.
Ms. Farver, all of you were asked about 21st century education. How will you achieve that when the district's technology lags behind the business world and many Detroit homes don't have access to the latest technology?
Well, when you say 21st century education, and then you also add the word technology into it, you are inferring that in order to be a 21st century organization, you have to be technology savvy. Am I correct?
Correct.
Okay. First, I had to get that clear. As a technology major, technology is not just about gadgets and software. And it's also about things that promote and help the community. In actuality, technology is something that should promote a better quality of life in the community. So that if you give the right education to a child that expounds upon things, that brings out their creativity, that brings about their community awareness, that brings about their civic duty, their social duty, and you make them well-rounded, to me, that would prepare them for being that high-tech person. Because if you have technology and you have a third-grade education, then you have nothing. So what you have to do is bring the child up emotionally and mentally and academically to be at a point where they can utilize technology and even contribute to the technology. Because a person, there are a lot of things that need to be done, and unless you have the education, the creativity to do it, then just because you have a, you know, technology skills or a computer skill doesn't mean that you're necessarily going to be able to use it. So with that being said, I think you have to start there first.
Thank you.
Ms. Arata, you pointed out earlier that the Financial Review Commission has for the foreseeable future say over most major decisions for the district. So two questions. One is, how would you engage with the commission? And given that that's what the reality is, why are you running for the board?
Because, thank you for asking. The Financial Review Commission is controlling our money, and we don't get out from under state control until we're out of debt. We have been forced to borrow money at a very high rate of interest. We have no control over that spending, and we also have 45 students in a classroom, which means almost anybody who can move is going to take their child out of the district because we can't get teachers to teach in these conditions, and the teachers are getting diminished every day, and we have students packed in like cattle. So therefore, for every child that leaves, we lose money. So we're in a position where we cannot get freedom because we can't get out of debt. So to answer your question, to engage with the Financial Review Board, there's only one thing that we can do. We must get rid of them. Just because it's a law, slavery was also a law. The legislature made us take on a debt which we did not incur. Our children are carrying that burden, and people who have nothing to do with our children are controlling their lives. This is a very unjust situation, and a law that is unjust is no law at all.
So, this question is for Ms. Carpenter, and it's related. What are your feelings about the recently passed state legislation regarding third grade reading and how DPS CD students will be affected? This is an audience question.
Okay, I'm sorry, could you repeat the question about third grade?
What are your feelings about the recently passed state legislation regarding third grade reading?
All right, I I disagree with it. My philosophy is, with the resources and the strategies that I am going to suggest to the board members, and if they agree with these strategies, empowering the teachers to be able to teach the children how to read. You know, I know it may sound so simple, but it really is that simple. If the children can read, there will be no children will be able to be left behind, held back, because they can't read. The goal is we're going to get them reading, because the teachers are going to be taught phonics, and they're going to be able to teach them how to read, and so we will not leave any child to be failed because they can't read, because we're going to resolve the problem. My philosophy is improve things. We know what the problem is, now let's do something about it. My strategies, as you mentioned earlier, I talk a lot about phonics because I know that's the solution to reading. Let's solve that problem right away, immediately. And that's what I would hope that the board members would collaborate with me on. So I don't agree with holding the children back. We have tutors that will tutor them. We have teachers that's going to teach them. The children's skills will improve for sure, because they're going to be actually taught how to read. Once they can read, we'll use the technology, and because they're in the era of technology, the children in this generation, they learn very well on learning things with the computer. I promote every child having a tablet, and I will do everything I can through my relationships with corporate America, which every child is going to have a tablet. You know, the benefit of me working with the organization of thousands of corporate American sponsors means that I'm going to make sure that the children receive the wraparound services and services they need to make our district a number one district, and work collaboratively with the rest of the board members to make this happen. And thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. This is going to be the last question in this round. I think everybody after this will have had three questions. Deborah Hunter Harville. You mentioned in your survey the need to understand how poverty affects student learning, and you say, quote, we must move them away from poverty and into a new paradigm of success. What does that mean?
In my mind, that means students can be in poverty, but don't really understand or don't have to feel like they're poor. I'm an example of that. I grew up on the east side of Detroit, and I attended Berry Elementary, and I was taught to excel to the highest level, and I got all A's, all right? And I went home, and I had peanut butter and jelly as a sandwich, and I did my homework. I never even thought I was poor. The church or faith-based community offered me wraparound services. So kids can be in poverty, but it just all depends on how the teachers explain to them about learning. Even though you're in poverty, you can still become excellent. And so I would want to have high expectations for learning, and I believe that teachers can be motivated to push that out forward, and many already do. I think that the times that I've heard that morale has been low, I think it's time for us to pick it up and move to the next level. Again, just because you live on the east side or the west side of Detroit and there's one parent raising you, you don't have to believe in your mind that you're in poverty. I'd also probably have staff read Lisa Delpit's book, Other People's Children, so you can know how to make them excited about everything. Learning is exciting, and it gets you to the next level. And that's what happened for me. Thank you.
Thanks. So we've asked three rounds of questions. We've got a few things in sort of this lightning round. Want to ask, with a show of hands, how many of you have previously or recently engaged with Detroit legislators regarding DPS's current legal status?
Hello? Okay, this is also a show of hands question. How many of you believe a forensic audit is necessary given the history of surplus, debt, and now shortfall? Everybody.
So this question is for each of you, and we're just going to go down the line, and I'm sorry I can't see all of your name tags from here, but we'll start with Ms. Baylor. 20 seconds, bonus points for being brief. Give me your best elevator pitch for why I should send my kids to DPS. Ms. Baylor?
I believe that we're at a critical moment in Detroit's history, and we have an opportunity right now to change the direction that we've been going in for the last few years. We have an opportunity to make our schools based on excellence and to keep every child at grade level all the way through to the 12th grade. And if they are at grade level all the way through 12th grade, they have the opportunity for free tuition to college, two-year colleges and 4 years, free tuition. And we've got to get that word out to three-year-olds in the preschool, to mothers in the maternity ward, so that they know this can happen with DPS. We have to partner with parents. I want to have home visits with parents and respect parents instead of always expecting them to come to us and build that relationship from the time the child is born. And there's so much more I could say, but quickly, art, music, drama, dance, physical education, all of those things that have been cut, we need to put them back.
Okay, so the elevator doors have closed. So give me literally 20 seconds, 30 seconds, elevator pitch, Mr. Caldwell.
So with all due respect, I am a lot like all the kids in DPS. I was angry growing up, single parent home. I graduated K-12 DPS, went on to get a PhD. I think you can be angry as a young black man, but the law does not allow me to be angry and have inaction or no solution, because I could be dead or in jail or I could get shot. So me being angry is not an effective solution. DPS just has to be competitive and say, we're gonna do the best with your most valued asset when you bring them to our schools.
Okay.
I would promote coming to a Detroit public schools because we have an excellent school system. We have certified teachers, we have music, we're gonna make sure we have music, art, physical education, health, money management, career and college training. We already have, as the young lady mentioned, we have the career and tech centers. So you can come to the career and tech center, you can get a quality education with quality teachers and a safe environment.
Thank you.
In spite of everything you've heard about DPS, we've produced a lot of educated, talented, creative people, to include most of the candidates who are running for school board.
Thank you. Bonus points for time.
All eyes are on us. Be a risk taker. Come back to Detroit. Stay with Detroit. If we're on the bottom and we're focused, we can't go anywhere but to the top. Thank you.
I would encourage parents who have their children in DPS to stay with us and help us take back our schools.
Thank you.
Don't believe everything you heard. Stop talking about it. Let's be about it. We are a community responsible for educating our kids with public education, which is a civil right.
We have some of the best teachers in the world who teach for DPS. And most important, you have Reverend Murray on the board, so never worry, vote for Murray.
What I would say to Detroiters in particular is that What I would say to parents that traditional public schools is needed, and a lot of people lost a life fighting for public education across this country. Please send your children back to DPS so we can continue fighting for our school and providing excellent education to our students.
Our teachers are some of the highest educated and have the most experience in the state, and they've shown their commitment to your children by remaining in the classroom no matter what's going on in their schools. And I know that for a fact because my mother is one of them.
My speed slate, saving public education with excellence in Detroit, that's the John Telford speed slate, and some members of that slate are sitting around this table right now. Traditional public education is the cornerstone of democracy, and we've all got to pull together. We don't need to charter our schools. We need to get all parents behind bringing our school district back to where it once was.
Detroit has the best schools that we can have. We have a program in DPS, DSA, that has won an international award. A choir went to South Africa and won, and nobody knew about it. But let me say this, no matter what they say, we are better than what the media or anybody else says about DPS.
Thank you all very much for your answers.
Okay, we have one more question that each of you will get 2 minutes to answer. It's one that we didn't really get to in the first few rounds, but it's probably one of the most important ones we'll ask tonight. And this comes from the audience. With the current conditions within our schools, overcrowded classes, lack of instructional resources, annually decreasing salaries, many capable teachers are leaving the district. How do you plan to stop the exodus and attract new capable educators to our district? Penny, do you want to start?
I am so happy you asked that question. I was afraid we were going to get through this whole thing without talking about the teachers. I really believe strongly that not only do we have to restore the cuts and the loans that teachers made to their salaries and their benefits, but we have to make them competitive statewide so that we can attract teachers. We have to improve the safety around the schools and in the schools, where a teacher doesn't have to worry that her car is going to be keyed in the parking lot or worse, or something violent might happen. We need to focus on that, because with what goes on in the classroom, in teaching and learning, is the most important thing that happens in a child's life. So the teachers are the key. Teachers are everything, and I know all of us can think of a teacher that changed our lives. So I think we have to treat people well, treat people like, well, we would want to be treated, and develop a partnership. But most of all, we have to be competitive statewide, or we will continue to have vacancies. We got to fight for those teachers and get them back to Detroit.
So I'm going to start with a short term and then hit long term. So short term, I would use an individual like a Professor Pedroni or other national experts to really investigate and do a study on how we can sustainably pay our teachers a fair wage for the practice that they're actually doing. So no one can actually answer the question, what should a teacher in Detroit be paid? But the board should be able to get experts to sit down and agree, look at data and information and research, and say, here's what you need to pay teachers in Detroit to have both the class size you want and the sustainable salary you want within the resources that you're allocated. The second part of my statement is, when you talked earlier about being competitive in a tri-county area, we need to make this a Detroit Plus conversation around equitable funding in public education. So my example is Troy and Birmingham and Novi still pay into MSPERS, which is the state retirement, but they also pay benefits and insurance. So they probably have some of the same lag that we've experienced, but we haven't engaged them either. We don't need it to be a Detroit problem to the legislature. We need it to be a statewide problem, a long-term plan for this board around what does equitable funding for public education look like in the state of Michigan, period. Thank you.
As a teacher, what would keep me or attract me to the district would be a appropriate salary, number one, and benefits. To me, those are the key things. Having small class sizes, having the resources that the district and the board will provide for teachers. Something else I think needs to be done to go outside of the city of Detroit and the state of Michigan and advertise for teachers that live in other states. I think that's very important. I don't think that's been done enough. I would also promote going to the HBCUs, the historically black colleges and universities, and recruit those teachers to come to this state and to teach. So if you had the salary, the benefits, you go outside of the state and you advertise for teachers to come here, we will get teachers here. Because if you just advertise here in this state, it's limiting the opportunities to bring qualified, committed, dedicated teachers such as myself. I am still teaching. This is my 40th year. And so I know that's what kept me here. Solid salary, benefits, and working with the team, administrators who care about the children. That's critical too. To be in this job, you have to care about children. And when we bring in teachers like that, believe me, the children will do well. They know that they are they loved, and they know that people are for them. Everything will, they will excel, and that's the most important thing, that students do well. Thank you.
This is a hard question to answer because teachers feel disrespected, they feel frustrated, they feel that they don't get a salary that they can actually live off of, and those are the reasons that they're leaving. I know of a teacher who just left and went to Southfield just about a week ago because she says she can't handle it, and she's frustrated, and she's had enough. So teachers need to be respected. They need to have a vested interest in the school system, so we have to give them more of a vested interest. We also need to fight, and this is outside of the board or in addition to, but we also need to fight the state legislators because there is a concentrated effort to destroy public school systems around the country, and they're doing it by wanting to cut down the pay and the benefits. So it's more than just what we can do locally, it's what needs to be done nationally. So we have to fight that fight, but we also have to try and respect the teachers, give them what they need to, in respect to, well, yes, that's true, but that's money, so that's probably where my brain went like, But anyway, we need to give them a vested interest. We need to try to get their salaries compatible because if they can't live off that salary, as much as they love Detroit, then they may have to leave. And the benefits. And those are the benefits and the salaries are things that legislators, states, and nationally they're trying to destroy because certain people do not want their tax dollars to be going towards that effort. What they want to do is bring in charter schools so somebody outside the city of Detroit can make a profit.
I agree with much of what has been said. I'd just like to add, whoever is on the board, the seven, should immediately begin to meet with the elementary teachers, the middle school teachers, and the high school teachers. They each have different needs, and then we can work towards getting funding from the legislators as well as writing policy to help them to get those things that will ultimately give us student achievement. Another thing I think we can do, and I've said that over and over, is we can build relationships with colleges and universities. We can do that over the year, and so we will be working with them through the junior year as well as the senior year, and then sometime around March, April, get to those universities, and because of funding, we probably would have to use technology to have those kinds of dialogues with them to recruit them to the city of Detroit. And I said before, particularly HBCUs, because remember, we've got to recruit people that really like children, that don't mind coming into urban places helping to increase achievement. Another thing that I know that we must do is have world-class training for our teachers. And many of our teachers are stars, okay? We just don't know they're stars because we haven't been in their classrooms to find out how they teach. And then lastly, I say grow our own teachers. There are parapros that could go to WC3 and could go on to Wayne State and Mary Grove and become teachers, and we could get funding perhaps for them. And that's 2 minutes. Thank you.
I'm gonna raise this issue because I haven't heard it raised, and I think it's really important and that we have lost sight of it. But you know, many years ago, the Supreme Court ruled that segregation was unconstitutional. And our schools are very segregated. They're not only segregated racially, they are segregated economically, and they're deeply, deeply, deeply unequal to the suburban districts, and more so now than ever. And now we do have legislation that says that the teachers hired can be uncertified. The reason I raise this is because the teachers that are not getting hired that are applying, and they're contacting us all the time that they're not getting the job, we understand that it's probably because they're waiting to hire uncertified teachers, because the teachers who have credentials are not getting hired. They are contacting all of us and letting us know that they have applied, especially in the bilingual department, where we have 65 students in a class. We have 65 students who don't speak English in one class with a teacher. This is a human rights violation. I'm asking for people to really think about the bigger picture, not how well we got along with Judge Rhodes, not how many nonprofits are putting up people so that they can wait for us to charter these schools. I'm talking about the bigger picture of what is fair and equitable in our schools. If we don't go back to the drawing board and sue on a Brown v. Kansas case, I think we're going down the wrong direction. We can ask for money from charities all day long, but we have a tax base that belongs to us. We have to stop begging and stop pushing charters. We have a right to public education, just like Ann Arbor does, just like Okemos does, just like every other major city that has public education. We have a right to that. We don't have to put up with charters on every corner.
Well, I think there's a certain amount of money that will be allocated. So we know that being a third generation UAW member, of course, collective bargaining and making sure that teachers have a livable wage with a great compensation package. That goes without saying. But I also think that there are other things that we can do to retain and acquire and actually respect the teachers that we have. We have to be able to support them with resources. If you've been in a classroom lately, my daughter's at CAS, she's taking pictures of her book on her phone. So that's very difficult for a teacher to teach that way. So there's also programs where we need to create recognition. It does no good to talk about great teachers within the district, and that's all who knows that we have great teachers. That needs to be public information, recognition programs to let us know who are those star teachers that we spoke about. Everything else that I've heard, of course, I definitely agree. But in collaborating with universities and colleges, we only want certified teachers. I only want a certified teacher teaching my children. And not a Teach for America teacher. I want a certified teacher that have went through the Michigan State requirements to get certified to teach my child. And if you have a problem with urban education in urban areas, you are not the teacher that I want teaching my child.
And I agree with everything I've heard, but I also say this. In order to make this thing work for our children, we have to get rid of these emergency managers and SpongeBobs. Because, see, the thing is, the teachers cannot teach when you got an uncertified emergency manager coming and telling the teachers how to teach, and they've never been to school to learn how to teach. We have, I served on the academic committee with another school board member in the audience, Ida Short, and we set up a plan where these children would be able to learn, even those who were in special education. And here you got somebody don't know nothing about education, came and closed the Oakman school down, and there's nowhere to send the kids to learn. So they're not interested in our children's learning. So we have to collaborate with the community and say no to those who want to destroy our children. And as a people, we have the power, and we will overcome. God bless you all.
Short term, I want to let everybody that can hear my voice and see my face know that I will never vote to charterize our school, Detroit Public Schools. I will never vote to allow a superintendent or anyone else hire uncertified teachers, first of all. Secondly, I want every teacher in DPS and around the city, those who left, those who stayed, to know that we really love them, we respect them, and we know that this has been a very hard role for them, as well as myself and everyone else probably up here having to watch how they degraded our students and our school district. And long term, how do we get qualified teachers in here? We make sure that we talk to the teachers. We make sure we bring in curriculums that the teachers was excited about, like African-centered studies. They were, a lot of teachers was excited about that. Teachers are excited about having an opportunity to be creative in the way that they teach, in the way that they serve. So I think that we need to start there with transparency, respect, and love.
I've yet to hear anything that I disagree with. If I could add to it, I would say that some of the things that I've been thinking about are how to lessen expenses in the other areas of teachers' lives. As we talk about the fact that their salaries and we are dealing with allocated dollars, so then that makes me think about their entire budget, their family budget. What are they paying at home? Where can they get discounts in certain areas? Can we set up something where teachers who live in the city are getting tax allowances similar to what we've done with police and fire? I'm also curious about, we know statistically that most of our teachers are coming from in-school colleges and universities. So how are we using those partnerships to get additional professional development for them, to get scholarship dollars for them if they have a bachelor's and want a master's? What are the ways that we're providing incentives and other support in other areas so that they can lessen what they have to spend at home and feel supported and valued? I think it's so essential that they feel valued by the district and by their leadership, and that they know that we understand they are people, not just machines sitting in the classroom, but whole entire people with entire lives that they'd like to live outside the classroom as well. So everything that I think about has to do with supplementing and providing for those areas.
Our teachers deserve combat pay. I have superintended suburban districts as well as Detroit. Of course, I superintended Detroit for $1 a year, so I didn't have combat pay. I didn't have any pay. Like, there's, I signed a contract for $1. They still owe me that dollar. Some of the teachers that I did supervise, either directly or indirectly, were good teachers, you know, out in Rochester and Madison District Public Schools, Plymouth Canton, some of those other places. After I left Detroit to climb the administrative ladder, I spent 22 non-consecutive years in the Detroit Public Schools at all levels. But, you know, some of those teachers who thought they were such hotshots, you know, put them at Martin Luther King or Finney High School for about 2 minutes and they'd be, you know, driving north real fast. So they certainly, and I will fight to get our teachers appropriately remunerated. But also, one has to remember that educator, the job of educator, really is a sacred mission. It goes beyond. I mean, I owe everything I am to the Detroit Public Schools. I mean, those coaches wouldn't let me stay in trouble. I mean, they sent me to Wayne State on an athletic scholarship. I ended up in the U.S. national team. Would that have happened without DPS? DPS was one of the best school districts in the country, and it was one of the best even in 1999 when they took us over. And we had $114 million surplus, and our test scores were at the state midpoint and rising. But Detroiters always passed millages. We did a $1.5 billion bond. Engler was the governor at that time. He was looking at that money with hungry eyes. Took us over because he could. Well, we're going to fight them. We're going to fight them tooth and nail until we get out from under this Jim Crow situation that they've imposed on us. And my own friends are saying, John Telford, are you nuts? Why did you go to work every day as superintendent? I did it because I care about this school district, and I owe those coaches who are long dead my whole life.
I think we have to counter what we call the dominant narrative, and that narrative says that all teachers are greedy. A laborer is worthy of their hire, and our teachers really deserve a whole lot more than they're getting. I know a teacher sitting in this room right now who's been teaching for 35 years, and because of the cuts, she now makes what she made year 10 in the public school system. But she stayed for all these years because she loves her students and has done great work with them. I think as we counter the dominant narrative, we have to encourage our teachers, both those who have been with us a long time and those who are coming, that they're coming to a great place, or they're in a great place, despite what we see. The other thing I think is respect. Respect from our teachers from both administrators as well as parents. That the job of being a teacher is not an easy one. I think I heard Combat Pay just now. It is not easy, but they, again, are worthy of what they do. The other thing I think is we need to ask teachers, what do you want? And I think if we ask them, I think we heard from elementary, middle school, and high school, what do you want? What can you live with? I think that's going to be tremendously important. Because again, we cannot have a great system with smaller classrooms if we don't have enough teachers. And we've got to be able to attract folks to come here, but also retain seasoned teachers to guide again in our system. So again, I think those things are needed for us to have a great system as well as to attract and to retain our teachers.
Thank you all for those answers. And finally, just a show of hands, this is a question from the audience. How many of you will continue to actively support the Detroit Public Schools even if you are not elected? Okay, thank you very much.
I'd like to take this moment to thank our moderators, Jerome Vaughn and Sarah Hewlett. Thank you very much. You have a difficult task of making all this go forward. I'd also like to acknowledge a couple people in the audience who are here. Ida Short is a school board member currently. Ida was scheduled to be here last Friday and unfortunately due to schedule conflicts was unable to make it. I want to appreciate your coming tonight. And if you want to check out her answers, take a look at the survey information. It's on the Grandmont website, and all of the surveys are up there. So will the videotapes that are going to be returned here, and you'll see the one on Channel 22 already from Friday, and this one will be coming up shortly. So we would like to have you do that. Also in the audience tonight, Iris Taylor was scheduled to be on the stage this evening. Unfortunately, she came quite late as a result of other schedule conflicts and didn't want to disrupt the questions and answers. So, Iris, we appreciate your coming in and completing the survey that's here. In addition, in the back, Kathy Montgomery is running for school board, and she's a candidate and running, and she's got her literature in the back regarding her position. So we appreciate your coming and joining us this evening for this forum. I would like to also thank the people who really made this possible. Councilmember James Tate has been instrumental, as we indicated to the beginning. And also, I didn't see you come in until late, but Representative Sherry DeNogo has been very much a part of this whole process, and we appreciate everything you've done to make this possible. Thank you very much. And again, to the candidates who took the time tonight to complete the surveys and take your time to answer all these questions, thank you very much. And I know that for all of us, I think we've learned a lot from each of you in terms of the issues and what you stand for. So thank you again for being a part of this program. And for all the folks from Northwest Detroit who are here tonight, thank you for coming out. Tell your friends about this. Look at the website. Thank you very much.